32nd Sunday in Ordinary Time. Father Bob, our pastor, is a celebrant, and Silverio, Deacon Silverio, is our homilist today. Please stand for the first one.
Thanks for your great glory, Lord. Almighty and merciful God, graciously keep from us all adversity, so that unhindered in mind and body alike, we may pursue in freedom of heart the things that are yours. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. Elijah the prophet set out and went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat and die." Elisha said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said, but first make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus is the Lord of God of Israel, the jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail, until the day of the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went and did as Elijah said, so that she as well as he and her household ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by Elijah. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is to appoint for human beings to die once, and after that comes the judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the temple, and a large crowd was listening to him. He said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses for the sake of appearance, say long prayers. They would receive the greater condemnation." Jesus sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she has to live on." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Sometimes we hear or read a message that really hits home. A message so deep that we're left speechless. The hopeless and unfortunate situation of the 2 widows in today's readings present such a message. So here we see 2 widows who have nothing left in life. They are basically waiting to die, and still, what little they have, they give away. In the first reading, the widow says to Elijah that she is going home to prepare a final meal for herself and her son, and then wait to die. In the gospel, we find a widow who gives away 2 measly coins, all that she has. Now, their standard of living is exemplary, so much so that Jesus portrays one of them as the model of the ideal disciple. One who gives not of their plenty, but out of their need. And here is where the message hit home. For most of us don't measure up to this standard of living, giving. I certainly don't. For to give what we need most is true selfless giving. The test of a gift is not what it amounts to in itself, but what its loss means to the giver. We have to give something that will cost us. As I read and reflected on these readings, I felt a sense of unworthiness and loss, like John the Baptist, who said he was unworthy to untie the thong
of Jesus' sandals. I also felt unworthy at the thought of what I could possibly say to you today that would do justice to the plight of these two widows. So I did some research by reading commentaries and stories about the widow's mite. And in doing so, I learned of another interpretation to this story. See, there is more here than just the moral generosity of a woman who had next to nothing and gave it all away to the temple treasury. There is hidden within this story a subtle message in the form of a warning. Now remember what Jesus is saying at the beginning of the gospel. Beware of social climbing scribes who crave positions of power and respectability while exploiting the poor people, especially vulnerable widows. And my friends, there's the context. These scribes and Sadducees were all part of the political religious temple complex that, like many governments, corporations, or public officials, had grown corrupt. They had their lobbyists, their briberies, and their scandals. It was an open secret, yet people could do little about it. One group called the Essenes, and scholars believe this is the group that John the Baptist belonged to, found the temple so corrupt that they moved out. They went and settled in the vicinity of the Dead Sea. Others stayed and gave passive resistance. Jesus is one of them. We are reminded that he sat down opposite the treasury. That is, he is there in silent protest. He is opposed to the whole temple atmosphere around money, with the rich parading their large sums. He is in effect doing a sit-in, just as he is obviously watching who is putting what in. And along comes this widow, one of those exploited. Poor as she is, she drops in two coins out of piety. Jesus sees this. He shakes his head and speaks out his words. This poor widow has put in more than all the others. From her poverty, she has contributed all she had. Now, Jesus' phrase for this woman is a raw sarcasm directed at the authorities. So, my friends, we are asked to hear these words of Jesus not as words of praise, but as words of lament, of sorrow and grief. Yes, a lament spoken with a heavy heart. Jesus is sorrowful, even angry that this devout woman has unwittingly put money into a system in which the scribes devour the houses of people like her. In this different interpretation, Jesus is feeling bad that this woman had just innocently contributed to a corrupt system that will turn right around and use her money to buy more expensive robes and pay for their high life instead of helping people like her, which they were supposed to do. Jesus is feeling bad that she has unknowingly cooperated in her own exploitation. It's not uncommon. The exploited are often so singled out and helpless that they do not see what is happening. Needless to say, Jesus' public sadness, his sitting, and his open criticism of the political powers caught their attention, and sooner or later, they would have to deal with him. Now, seen in this light, this incident of the widow's mite is really not a story about a woman's generosity as much as it is a story about the exploitation of the vulnerable and the meanness and greed of the system that exploits them. Jesus' words are not words of praise, but words of sadness. And it's not a stretch to think that Jesus sits opposite some large corporation, some government building or municipal hall today, and laments over the taxpayers and the needy who must support them. In fact, he does so in his followers, his true followers. Now, Jesus is not asking any of us to go on an investigative binge, looking everywhere for corruption and exploitation of the weak and vulnerable. For you see, we are truly blessed to live in a country where corruption and exploitation of the poor is very low. I looked this up, and Canada is listed as the 12th least corrupt country out of 180. Now, this does not mean that corruption and exploitation is non-existent. It's just, it's not an open secret. Our country has had its share of corruption and scandal, and unfortunately, these still go on today. All one has to do is type in corruption in Canada in the Google search bar to find a very comprehensive list. Here in Ontario, we've had our own share, which is public knowledge, from the Orange scandal to the OPP Association money laundering. Auto insurance fraud is big, and even some charities are found to be corrupt. Now, none of these are related to the Catholic Church. So you see, exploitation and corruption still exist today. Many people continue to be victims of institutions that are meant to help and benefit them. Institutions that end up taking everything they have. Hence the message of this gospel, that we are to do all we can to help stop it, and especially not to contribute to it. So, my friends, it turns out that this familiar gospel is not so familiar after all. Maybe it's not just about the simple message of a poor woman of great heart who shames the flamboyant high and mighty with her two coins. Maybe it's about legal corruption and the Jesus who is saddened that good people are exploited by the system and must pay into it. But we kind of like the old interpretation. In a way, it's safer. But this one is more spiritually challenging. It challenges us to confront evil wherever we find it, to sit across the treasury, so to speak, and to lament and to do what we can to cleanse the system and bring justice for the poor and the marginalized. In short, it challenges us to be like Jesus. Amen. As it turns out, the difficult message didn't leave me all that speechless, seeing that I shared these words with you and I had help. But I do hope that some justice was done to the poor widow's plight by shedding some light on the challenges that she and all of the world's poor face. I hope to have brought some measure of justice to their cause.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. God is close to all who call on Him from deep within their hearts. Let us bring our needs before our Lord, confident that He will listen to our prayer and answer our needs.
For the leaders of the church, that they may teach and practice the values of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who continue to suffer in the COVID pandemic, and for the frontline workers who serve them, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who work, whose work is hard, and who seldom receive recognition, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
those who have much. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all our sick relatives and friends, and for those listed in our bulletin sick list, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for those whose names are listed on the All Souls envelopes, and all those who have died. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our loved ones who have died and those who died this past week, especially Margaret Kroll, Fanny Ferlin, Father Paul Casulo, Ida Cavallo, and all those who rest in our cemeteries, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and ever-living God, your love for us surpasses all of our hopes and desires. Forgive us of our failings, especially our selfish hearts. Keep us in your peace and lead us in the way of salvation. And we make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So that you might love in us what you love in your Son. by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost to disobedience. And so, Lord, with the angels and saints, we too give you thanks as an exaltation we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Thomas, our bishop, with the order of bishops and all the clergy and the entire people
your son has gained for his own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Lord Jesus Christ, gather us to
Christ, one bread, one body, in your love, we do proclaim you the Savior of all, Lord of all the earth and sea and sky. Lord Jesus Christ, gather us together, make us one bread, one body, in your love. Forgive our failings, create us anew, speak your words of peace into our hearts. Lord Jesus Christ, gather us together, make us one bread, one body, in your love. Into your hands, Lord, we place all our cares, trusting in your love, which never fails. Lord Jesus Christ, gather us together, make us one bread, one body, in your love. Within your temple, your praises we sing, glorious is your name for all the earth.
For all those who died in war, whether whether the reasons for war have ever been good or bad isn't the point. We have a lot of people who die from it. So we share great freedom. So we should keep them in our prayers. Also, anyone who is 18 years old, who's a young man, who's 18 or older, who would like to cultivate a deeper spiritual life, and perhaps even move towards priesthood or diaconate, there's a retreat on Saturday, November 20th at St. Augustine Seminary. It's they don't do overnights anymore. COVID is one of those things. But there's still that Saturday retreat if you're interested. Also, just a reminder the Cardinal reminded us again about our requirement for what they call contact tracing. Now, we haven't actually had a need here to notify anyone, which is a great gift. Many of the parishes in the diocese have, and they had sign-up sheets and everything else, and I was thinking, sign-up sheet, everybody's picking up the same pen in there. It's kind of crazy. So we always try to do the email thing. So if we don't have your email address, you should probably let us know, just in case, God forbid, we have to notify you. So the Cardinals just remind us of that. Also, just so you know, there's a CWL are doing a Panettone fundraiser. And one of the main things they're looking at is what the parish needs. And you know, one thing about Mother's Day, I gotta really praise Mothers. They see stuff that us guys never see. So they want to make sure that they put baby change tables downstairs and upstairs. So it's a wonderful thing. As soon as they said it, I said, well, that's a great idea. I used to talk about that myself. But Mums are great for that, so I want to thank them for that. So that's one of the projects they're going to be working on this year through the fundraising. And next weekend, of course, the second collection is for Shepherd's Trust. Anyways, I thought about the homily and everything this weekend. I wanted to say thank you. I want to thank you for all your contributions. Thank you for all your efforts. Thank you for all of what you do, care for the poor. Certainly, one of the things about corruption, which I think is important, is that every single Roman Catholic Church has a registered charity number, and you can actually go to CRA, and you can actually look at, like, a pie chart of how we spend the money, like how much goes through administration, how much goes through different things, and it's worthwhile doing that with every charity. So at least you know what's going on. If you don't know what's going on, it's not such a good thing. But the CRA has that for everybody, so you may want to check that out. Also, just one of the things that came to mind was in 1997, the year after I was ordained, they were looking for a young man from the first ordained group. And because of my business background, they put me on a committee, and it was a committee for the Archdiocese for procedures. And at that time, we had put forward that every Roman Catholic Church should be audited every 3 years. So we had internal auditors to come in and audit the church every 3 years to make sure that funds are being spent properly and that we have accountability, right? And that's been going on since 97, so keep that in mind. And they're always looking for little things like, you know, Father, remember, your alcohol has to go through your pocket, not the parish's, you know, things like that. And of course, in my case, I don't even buy dessert, but there's maybe a little more food than it should be in the budget. That I struggle with. But it's always kind of nice to have that second eye looking over, because we need it. We all, every single one of us. And just so you know, when I moved in, there were two vestments in the church, because, of course, Father Gary stays with them. And of course, I have all these vestments that every time I travel, I get them. So I got this one back in the year 2000 in Rome, and I got it for 30 euros. And in Rome, it's like they said, like 7-Elevens with them. Vestments just all piled up. And 30 euros, so, you know, in Rome, it's dirt cheap. And even now, they're only 50 euros even now, where they're $600 or $700 here. So it's amazing, the difference. And the truth is, the deacons also, just because we were talking about clothing and stuff in the gospel, they bought all their own vestments. So it's really important to kind of keep that in mind when I'm spending your money that way. And every once in a while, it's good that you know that. But the most important thing I wanted to say to you was thank you. Thank you for your donations. Thank you for your help. Thank you for all of what you do. If you didn't hear me, I want to say it again. Thank you for your generosity and your goodness. And just in case you didn't hear me, you already heard me. Thank you for all of what you do. It's such a great gift. I appreciate that. I want to thank the musicians for playing so wonderfully for us. the ushers for doing so much, the readers, the Christian ministers, our two girls who are serving today, and the deacons. I want to thank all of you for all of what you do in the name of Christ. Have a wonderful and blessed week.
Thank you, Father.
Nourished by this sacred gift, O Lord, we give you thanks and beseech your mercy, that by pouring forth of your Spirit, the grace of integrity may endure in those your heavenly power has entered, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for the faithful and the not so faithful departed. Eternal rest grant upon them, O Lord, and let the perpetual light shine upon them. May the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks
be to God.
Then shall we know.